Words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us cope. In this world, where'er we roam, ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words
Moving to a new country can be a difficult experience. New food, new language, new culture. It can be overwhelming and even scary. Adventists in South Korea wanted to create a space to help people integrate into the country while feeling supported. The Adventist Multicultural Family Service Center is an urban center of influence situated in a diverse area in the city of Ansan, where many foreigners come to work. Most of them don't know how to speak, read, or write the Korean language when they arrive, so the center offers free Korean language courses. More than 400 people go through this program every year. A few years ago, the staff at the center developed a plan to improve and expand their operations. This new plan offered a holistic experience to others in the community. Some of the most widely used services are the center's various shelters. These include an emergency shelter for those who have no income or housing, and group shelters for single parents. The families who stay in the shelters are offered free meals as well as safety. Many of the foreigners don't know how to navigate the healthcare system, so the center provides free dental care services once a week and general medical treatments once a month. Additionally, visitors have access to counseling services. As a result of the center's presence in the community, a number of new congregations have formed in a variety of languages. Groups meet and worship in Russian, English, Urdu, Chinese, and Korean. They have been blessed with up to 30 baptisms in a single year. The center has a heavy focus on children and youth. First, a kindergarten was established. Then, an after-school program was created for elementary students. This gave parents a place to send their children for tutoring and after-school care. For the parents who needed to work late, the center established a night protection care program where children would be supervised until 9 o'clock in the evening. The Korean-Russian School Academy for elementary and secondary students is especially popular. There are more than 60 students enrolled. The staff at the center see new, exciting opportunities to connect with families, but they need your help. This quarter, a portion of the 13th Sabbath offering will help provide other care services for immigrant children in Ansan, South Korea. Please consider what you can give to this opportunity. Thank you for supporting the 13th Sabbath offering.
Good morning, and welcome to Adult Sabbath School Bible Study Online at Vallejo Drive Church. We're so glad you chose to join today to worship with us. As we take a look at the story of Moses, we're going to be focusing on Deuteronomy chapters 1 through 3 and select passages from the Old and the New Testament. We're not going to do all of that today, but I invite you to go on your internet browser, type in the words Sabbath School Lesson, and it will put one of the first lines up there. Will give you the latest Sabbath School study that we're following in our what we call the Adult Sabbath School Quarterly. And so we're excited that we have some great authors who are contributing to this quarter's lesson study. And we're grateful that God worked through such a man as Moses so that we can learn how God wants to relate to us and how he calls us to himself, how he works through us, that we can make a great difference, just like he did through Moses. So with that, as we take a look at a few select passages and studies from this week's lesson, I invite you to bow your heads with me in prayer. God, for your goodness in our life, we thank you. For revealing how you relate to your people through the life of Moses and Israel, we praise you. Lord, I pray that our lives will be transformed completely because of today's study, and because we spend time with you each and every day through prayer, Bible study, and service to others. Guide and lead us, we pray. Amen. So as we look at our study today, the first thing we take a look at is God working in history. God is working through the life of Moses. And there's many historical lessons we can get as we study Moses' life. So just as God had worked in people's lives, so he worked in Moses' life. From Moses' birth, God was already at work miraculously throughout his life and growing up, his leadership, his marriage, even until the very moment right before Israel was going to go into the Promised Land. At Moses' death, God was at work, and even beyond the grave, God shows us how he works in our lives through Moses' life. And that's an exciting story to check out, starting in the book of Exodus, especially chapter 3. What's interesting is when we look at the life of Moses, we recognize that he's the author of the first five books of the Bible, and many scholars believe of the book of Job as well. And it's interesting how we have to wait until Exodus to really hear about Moses. So Moses has had a great impact on our thinking about God, our theology of God, because God's Spirit was at work in Moses' life. So there's a couple questions I want to invite you to consider through our study and this week that you can take out a journal, piece of paper, maybe in the back of your Bible. There's a few blank pages that allows you to take notes. But find in your place, whether it's your phone, computer, Bible, or a notebook, a place to answer the following questions that you're going to see on the screen right now. What are some of the ways that God led you in the past that can help you learn to trust Him for the future? And why is it important not to forget how God has worked in our lives? These are important questions. In fact, they help feed our faith. Whenever we feel weak in faith, we can remember how God has led us in the past. Not to limit our thoughts or to limit God's creativity or to limit God in doing a new thing, but when we remember how God has worked in the past, it leads us to this thought: God worked before, He will work again. And God is up to new things, like the Bible says. God says, I'm going to create a new thing. So what we want to be doing is remembering how God has led us and celebrate and praise Him for that, but not to get stuck in the past. We want to help us to look forward. Thank you. I finally found my words. To look forward. To know that God is going to be with us every step of the way, just like He was with Moses. When I look back at my life, I see how God has been merciful and gracious to me in those times that I really failed in the Christian walk, when I chose my own way, when I decided to try to take the reins of my life and try to guide it the way I thought it should go, when actually I should just let it go and let God be the one to guide. God's been so gracious. I've seen God do miracles, not just through me, but in my presence, having a front row seat. I've seen God who has quietly also encouraged me during difficult times in life. Where has God blessed you in your past? And how can we keep that, the importance of that, in our minds as we look to our future and as we move in our present? So let's consider a couple other things that the story of Moses brings to our attention about God as we look at our lesson study this week. The second thing is the ministry of Moses. The ministry of Moses can never be overstated. As God worked through Moses, He worked through him in many different ways. Moses was a prophet. He passed on the message that God gave to not only God's people, but He also gave the message to Pharaoh and the Egyptians, especially when the Israelites were captives in Egypt. So Moses was a prophet. Moses also was a shepherd. He led the people as God showed him where to go. He cared for the people. He provided for the people. There's some amazing roles that Moses took on in his relationship with Israel that shows us is a parallel to how Jesus took on His role with us humanity. And one of the first things we're going to look at today is found in Exodus chapter 32, verses 29 through 32, and it reads like this. Then Moses said, "Consecrate yourselves today to the Lord, that He may bestow on you a blessing this day, for every man has opposed his son and his brother." Now it came to pass on the next day that Moses said to the people, "You have committed a great sin, so now I will go up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin." Then Moses returned to the Lord and said, "Oh, these people have committed a great sin and have made for themselves a god of gold. Yet now, if you will forgive their sin, but if not, I pray, blot me out of your book which you have written." Moses was many things to God's people. And here we find in his statement, asking God if God won't forgive them of their sin of taking gold elements, putting it together, making a mold, and making a golden statue to worship. If God won't forgive them for that, Moses is saying, "God, blot me out. May I be in their place of being blotted out of your book." What is this book? Well, the book of life. God's salvation that He wants to offer to His people. And so here Moses is stepping in as an intermediary, as one who says, "I will give my life. I did not commit this sin, but I will give my life for these people." That's a parallel to what Jesus did for us. Jesus, who never sinned, He steps in and says, "I've never sinned. My people that I love, they have sinned. I will bear their sin. I will go to death in their place so that they might have life." Moses' life in many different ways. He lived knowing or not knowing that oftentimes it would become a parallel to what Christ was going to do for us. Jesus, our Redeemer, is going to lead us out of the house of sin, out of being slaves to Satan's thinking and Satan's influence, and lead us into the journey of the wilderness on earth, a way of living our lives, following God, obeying Him, loving Him, knowing Him, until we get to what we are told is the promised land, or the heaven and the earth made new. Moses, he was an erring human being. He was sinful. He needed a Savior as well. But in this moment, after the Israelites, under Aaron, the first priest, right, of Israel in the sanctuary system, here Aaron creates a golden calf for them to worship while Moses is on the mountain. And Moses comes down and he's so angry, he takes the first tablets that God wrote, the Ten Commandments, with his own finger on, and he throws them to the ground and breaks them. He is so angry, so upset with God's people for turning to something else and worshiping it instead of worshiping the living God. And yet he steps in to be a substitute, an intermediary for the people. Wow, to sit at Moses' feet, to watch him as he leads the people, would have been an amazing experience. But here we have Moses who steps in, and we see him take that role. Moses' life here shows us how God wants and has already sent his son to step into the role of substitute, to take our guilt, our shame of our sin upon him. As 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, so that you and I can become righteousness unto God. Well, as we look at Moses' life further in this lesson, we're also shown how God fulfills his prophecies in Moses' life. Let's consider a couple events in Moses' life. First, when God comes to Moses there in the wilderness to call him to be a leader, to go to Israel and to Egypt with a message, God proves to Moses who he is. You know, he says, Moses, what's in your hand? A staff. He goes, throw it down and it becomes a snake. Pick it up and it becomes a staff again. God is a miracle worker. His word goes forward and it affects a miracle. It affects a change. Miracles are often defined as supernatural or extraordinary events outside of natural law. Moses also had his hand. He said, Moses, put your hand inside of your coat. So he puts it in, he pulls it out. There's leprosy. He puts it back. It's clean. No problem. But we also see where God then gives a prophetic utterance to Moses when he tells him what he's going to do when he sends him to Egypt. And the message he's supposed to give Pharaoh so that Pharaoh will let go of his people. The 10 plagues, right? Here are the 10 plagues. God tells Moses to tell Pharaoh, if you don't let my people go, this will happen. Pharaoh said, I'm not letting him go. Then God's word was made good. That happened 10 times. 10 times God proved to Moses and to the Israelites and to Egypt that God keeps his word. So here we take a look at another incident when God led Moses and the Israelites through the wilderness to the promised land. They're on the edge, right? They're not quite there yet. They've come to the river and they're about to cross the river, and Moses sends in 12 spies, and the 12 come back. 10 give a horrific, sad, discouraging, disparaging report to the people, which caused the people to be discouraged, dismayed, and even wanting to stone Moses and some of the other leaders. But here was Joshua and Caleb who said, no, we can take the land. God is going to give it to us. We can take it. But the people rebelled against God. They would not move forward in faith. And so God said, I'm sending you out into the wilderness. And this is the prophetic utterance God gave that we find here in Numbers 14:34 that says this. According to the number of the days in which you spied out the land, 40 days, for each day you shall bear your guilt 1 year, namely 40 years, and you shall know my rejection. God prophetically says, because the spies were in the land for 40 days and the 10 came back with a bad report, and because you rebelled against me, that you would not obey and go forward to take the land I'm going to give you, I'm going to send you to the wilderness. For every day that the spies were in the land, it's going to be 1 year out in the wilderness. 40 days times 1 year is 40 years. God made good on his promise. In fact, when God sent that generation out into the wilderness to wander and not take up their land just yet until they learned to love God, till they learned to trust God, till they learned to obey God from a willing and loving heart, until his word became fixed in their mind and heart, God said they're going to wander the wilderness. And what's interesting the only people from the original generation, when they came back 40 years to that same place before they're crossing the Jordan River, the only two people that were going to go in from the original generation were Joshua and Caleb, the ones who exercised faith 40 years earlier. See, God's word, when we see it fulfilled in Scripture, when we see it fulfilled in Earth's history, gives us confidence that God, when He speaks words to our hearts, that He will fulfill that word inside of us. I love the passage in Isaiah 55, verse 11, that reads like this. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. Again, the prophet Isaiah reiterates the idea that God Himself, His words that He speaks, have power. They affect a change in our lives. So when you read the Scriptures, and when you read John 3:16, and it said, "For God so loved the world," you can be sure, because of God's fulfilling His prophetic utterances in the past, that when He says, "I love the world," that you and I are part of that world. That when God says, "I love you," you can let that word settle into your heart, and it will break your hardened heart, that worries that, can God love me even though I've sinned greatly, even though I knew His name, even though I chose against Him? You can believe that God's word is true. This is the point of seeing how prophecy is fulfilled. It gives us confidence in the words of God. When God says that he sent Jesus Christ to die for the ungodly, or that in Ephesians where He says, "Even though you were dead spiritually, I made you alive." God, when He speaks His words to us, those words are great confidence in us. They are a surety for us. You know, God always keeps His words, even when we don't keep our word to God. God is faithful to us, even when we have not been faithful to Him. Because God's word stands and lasts forever. I invite you to look at Isaiah 55 today, this afternoon or this evening, before the sun goes down, just to take a look and read it for yourself. Let those words of Isaiah 55, and where it describes the Word of God especially, and how that Word of God makes all the difference in our lives. There's a lot more we could say about the life of Moses, and you're going to be able to study that in our Sabbath school lesson over the next few months. But let's just summarize briefly what we looked at today. Today we looked at how God works in Moses' life that shows us three things. Number one, God is at work in history, and we should always remind ourselves how He's worked in the past so that it gives us confidence that He will work in new, old, and rejuvenated ways in our future. The second thing we're reminded is that God has sent a mediator, one who will be a substitute for us, one who has already taken upon our guilt, our shame, and our sin upon Him at the cross, and that's Jesus Christ. Jesus stepped in so that He took our punishment, which we deserve, so that we might take the life and righteousness which He deserved, and we can live a new life because of that. And the third thing that God shows us through Moses' life is that God keeps His words. When God speaks promises in Scripture, He will fulfill them. Even if we don't understand how He's going to do that, even if everything around us tells us that God can't, God's Word can. God's Word is powerful. And as we read the Bible and open it up to us, I pray that as you read it, that you'll let those words speak to your heart and mind each and every day this week. So until next time, we pray that you will be blessed in God working in our history, in our story, in our very lives each and every day. Let's pray. God, we thank You for working in the life of Moses. We thank You, God, how You've showed Your character, Your goodness, Your mercy, Your love for us through his life as he led and loved on the Israelites. Lord, I pray that we will remember to always seek and to understand and to give You glory for how You have worked in our past, so that shows us You're working now and in our future. Lord, thank You for sending Jesus to be our substitute, to die in our place this second death so that we might live eternally unto You. And Lord, we thank You also that we are reminded that you do keep your word, and we can have confidence in you, and that, Lord, your word is sure and will bring a transformation in our very lives. Bless us in a special way, we pray. Amen. If you're hearing this message from us for the first time, and you haven't visited our church yet, we'd love to invite you to our service, which will be online at 11 a.m. You can go to our website, and it'll point you in the right direction where you can watch it. Also, we would love to have you visit us in person when you're ready and you're comfortable. We'd love to meet you and get to know you. So you can either drop us a message through Facebook, or you can email one of us pastors. Just say pastor and the first name of the pastor at vallejodrive.church. So, for example, we have Pastor James at vallejodrive.church. We have Pastor Lauren at vallejodrive.church. We have Pastor Linda at vallejodrive.church. And you have me, Pastor Ben, at vallejodrive.church. We hope to hear from you soon, and have a blessed Sabbath day.